Hello students, I am Nitin Swami and welcome to this last video on translation. And in this video lecture we would be seeing about the mechanism of translation, how the entire process goes on. In our last video lecture we had seen about genetic code, and in this video lecture we'll be seeing how protein synthesis happens. So when we see the process of translation, it is the last process of the central dogma, but yet very important process. So in this process, ribosome translate the genetic message of RNA into protein, and the mRNA is translated in 5-3 direction corresponding N and C terminal polypeptides. So amino acid bound to tRNA are inserted in the proper sequence due to specific binding of each amino acid to its tRNA and specific base pairing between the mRNA codon and tRNA anticodon. As we had already seen, this is the structure which is telling us about the various subunits or the structures which are getting used in the process of translation. Ribosome, anticodon, codon, small ribosomal unit, and tRNA. So in broad terms, if we see it, then we should be studying about tRNA, we should be studying about ribosome, and we should be studying about mRNA. These three components come together and create a process known as translation. So first we will see transfer tRNA. This tRNA is a 4 double-stranded stem loop structure in which we have various parts, like at the 3' end we would be having ACC structure, ACC sequence, which would be common in all the species, and after that we have T, Pi, C arm, and we have extra arm or variable arm, and this is the arm which is differentiating each tRNA from other tRNA. And this is anticodon arm, where the anticodons are present and they bind with mRNA. And then we have D arm and loop. These are the basic structure. And if we see this tRNA structure in 3D, we would be finding a structure like this. And this is 2D structure. And here we can see these are the variable. This is a variable arm which makes the difference between different types of tRNA. And now we'll move on to the ribosome. Ribosome is one more very important, or rather known as the factory of protein synthesis. It is a very huge subunit, and it in prokaryotes and eukaryotic ribosome, there is vast difference. In prokaryotes, it is 70S, and in eukaryotes, it is 80S. And if we further see, in prokaryotes, the large subunit is of 50, and small subunit is of 30S, and then which is further divided into 23S plus proteins plus 5S rRNA, and in a small subunit, it is divided into 16S and then 21 proteins. And eukaryotes also, the large subunit is of 60S and small subunit is of 40S, which is further subdivided into 28S and plus 49 proteins, and in small subunit it is 18S plus 33 proteins. And if we see this comparison, we find one peculiar thing over here, that the entire structure of ribosome is made up of predominantly of RNA, which is supported with the help of proteins. So if we see the fraction of it, then the 60 to 65% of the ribosome is composed of rRNA, and rest of the composition is of proteins. So if we see this structure, this and its assembly, so ribosome can be divided into large and small subunit, as we had just seen it there. And if we see this, we'll find one thing, that various initiation factors which comes and binds to small subunit, which then subsequently get binds to the mRNA which is coming, and in the third part the large subunit would also join the complex. So to make sure that there is a bind, there is a proper affinity between mRNA and ribosome in small subunit, there is one sequence which is always there, that is UCC-UCCA. And this sequence makes shows that binds to a sequence that is in our mRNA, and that is upstream to AUG sequence, and this sequence would bind to this sequence which is present in ribosome, and this pairing makes sure that there is proper affinity between your ribosome and your mRNA. So now we move on to the process of translation. The very first process in translation is charging of tRNA. When we say the term charging of tRNA, what does it refers to? So it refers to the addition of amino acid onto the tRNA. How this process is occurring? So for that, we do have enzyme, which is known as synthetase enzyme, amino acyl synthetase enzyme. And there are two classes of these enzymes, and both the classes have their subsequent amino acids, which is to be loaded on to tRNA. And there are 20 different amino acids, and there should for one amino acid each. So there has to be synthetase also for this process. And if we see the structure, this is that enzyme which is known as amino acyl tRNA synthetase. This enzyme reacts with amino acid, it has many pockets. One pocket is for amino acid, and then one pocket is for the attachment of ATP, and the last pocket is for tRNA, that is uncharged tRNA. So we see the first structure, this valine is coming and it is attaching to the first pocket, and after that ATP is also coming and making sure that amino acid binds to this enzyme. And after this enzyme catalyzes coupling of amino acid to AMP to form amino acyl AMP. So in this structure, two phosphorus are going away from the system, and now it is amino acyl AMP. And after this thing, uncharged tRNA would come and bind to the last pocket of the enzyme, and after that enzyme transfers, and then this amino acyl synthetase transfers this amino acid valine to the tRNA to form amino acyl tRNA. So amino acyl tRNA is a tRNA which is having amino acid onto its stop. That is ACC sites we had already seen at 3' end. And after that, this assembly gets disintegrated, and tRNA is charged now having amino acid here, like we can see over there. It is valine here, and it is amino acyl tRNA. And then the assembly would disintegrate, and again the cycle would go on and go on till infinity. So this reaction is a reversible reaction, where this amino acyl tRNA synthetase is getting used again and again. So now our amino acid is charged. So now we can see this is our ACC part, that is our last three nucleotide of all tRNAs, and here amino acid comes and get attached to this part, this place you can see over here. So this is charged amino acid. Now we are having amino acyl tRNA, which is charged. So now we'll go into the process of translation. So we can divide the process of translation into three phases, that is initiation, elongation, and termination. So there are some similarities in prokaryotic and eukaryotic translation, but there are differences too. But here we are studying a general mechanism of prokaryotes only. So under the term initiation, we would be requiring an mRNA, a ribosome, a specific initiator tRNA, initiating factors, and magnesium ions to initiate the reaction. And apart from that, there are some initiation factors also known as IF1, IF2, and IF3. And these IF1, IF2, and IF3 helps in the initiation process. So in the initiation process, we would be having our ribosomal 30S ribosomal subunit to which mRNA would come and get binds. How does this process gets on? Because the ribosome has to find the correct place, that is AUG, from where the reaction would start. So for that, an additional sequence, that is 8 to 12 nucleotide upstream from AUG, is commonly involved, as in that diagram we had already seen. And the sequence was discovered by Schein and Delgarno. So on their name, the sequence is known as Schein-Delgarno sequence. and the complementarity between this Shine-Delgado sequence and of mR and between the 16S rRNA appears to be very important in the binding of ribosome to mRNA. This sequence is in mRNA. So now we see this diagram. Here we can see one thing, that is, this is our mRNA, and here we can see that this is AUG, the starting codon for methionine, and here we can see upstream of it there is a sequence known as Shine-Delgado sequence. At the same time, initiation factor along with GTP would come and get binds to 30S ribosomal unit, and at the same time our first tRNA, charged tRNA, monoacyl tRNA, comes and gets bind and it makes the 30S initiation complex. So when we say the 30S initiation complex, it is yet not completed because 50S ribosomal subunit has not come. So in this 30S subunit, we are having 30S subunit, then we have mRNA, and mRNA is getting bind to the 30S sequence, and this is Shine-Delgado sequence, and there they bind, and after that we are having F-methionine in the case of bacteria, and after the process is done here, 50S ribosomal unit comes, and at the same time 1 and 2, the initiation factor would leave the complex, and here we can see a 50S ribosomal subunit is coming and getting bind here. So now this is 70S initiation complex. Now this is a complete initiation complex which would go further. So we can see here, this is a sequence at 3 prime side of rRNA, that is 16S AUUCCUCCAUGA, and here we can see this is a example of mRNA leader and 16S rRNA pairing. Here we can see Shine-Delgado sequence is getting attached to this particular segment, which is there in 16S rRNA. And this segment, or this particular sequence, is very important in making sure that mRNA comes and gets bind to correct position. And after that, since that thing is done, and we had already seen over there that formal methionine is the first amino acid or tRNA that comes to the mRNA, and it is having AUG as sequence. And after this, the initiation part starts, and the main difference we can find that in the eukaryotes, methionine is not modified, so there is no formal methionine, there is only methionine, and the ribosomal binding involved 5R cap rather than Shine-Delgado sequence. As we had seen over there, that in the last part of transcriptional modifications, we had seen the 5' cap, we do have capping at 5', which is helped here for the proper attachment of mRNA to the ribosome. And one more difference is here, then the here is like the initiator complex scan the mRNA for Cusack sequence instead of Shine-Delgado sequence, and which also have that includes AUG codon as their start codon. And then we'll move on to the elongation part. In the elongation part, there are three steps. The first is binding of aminoacyl tRNA to the ribosome. The second is formation of peptide bond between two amino acids. And the last process is translocation of the ribosome to the next codon. So if we see this structure, we'll find all these three steps here. So this is our 70S initiation complex, as we had already spoken of. So this is our 70S initiation complex. And in the second part, we can find that there many elongation factors are coming. EFTS, EFTU, and TS, they form a complex there. And after that, we can see here that it is bringing one more tRNA that is charged. So in the second part, we can see in a complex with elongation factors TU and GTP, the next amino acyl tRNA molecules bind to the exposed codon in the A site of the ribosome. Like before this, we'll just come back to the first structure and we'll see something here. Here in large subunit of the ribosome, we find three sites. E site, that is exit site. Then we have this site, P site, that is peptidal site where the peptides bond formation occurs. And then we have empty A site. And now we'll see this thing. Once the formal methionine comes and binds to the AUG sequence, the first slot is empty. And in this empty slot, one more amino acyl tRNA molecule would come. Since here we have UCC, and the complementary of UCC, the codon of UCC is for serine. So tRNA, amino acyl tRNA for serine would come and would sit here. So now we can see formal methionine, and then we have serine at our A site. And after this thing, the peptidal bond between these two amino acids would form, and the reaction would be catalyzed by peptidyl transferase. This is an enzyme which is present in the large subunit of ribosome. The linked amino acids are attached to the tRNA in A site. Now we can see the formal methionine has broken its bond with the tRNA, that is for formal methionine, and now formal methionine has a peptide bond with serine. So now the bond formation has taken place. The second part is done. And after this, along with the involvement of many elongation factors, we would find the translocation process. Translocation is a process where ribosome gets moved from one codon to another codon to the right side to the next codon. Here we can see here at the A site, we were having a codon for serine. Now in the next diagram, we can see here that translocation has taken place and ribosome has moved one codon ahead. And here at A site, we are finding AAG. And at our P site, we are having UCC, that was for serine. And at the AUG, which was the initiator codon, has come to the position, that is E site. And since its work is done, so it can leave the complex as we are seeing here. Now this uncharged tRNA would leave the complex and the reaction would go on like this. And the next amino acyl tRNA for AAG would come and the cycle would repeat again and again. So in our elongation step, we are not having many things. We are having only three things. That is binding of amino acyl tRNA to ribosome. And the second is formation of peptide bond. And the third was translocation. As all the three things we have seen here we can see binding of amino acyl tRNA to the site done, formation of peptide bond done, and then translocation as we had seen here. And after this, we'll go to the next part, that is, before going to the next part, we can see here, this is a structure where we were having formal methionine at P site, and we were having amino acid for serine, that is serine tRNA, amino acyl tRNA. So now here we can see the peptidyl transferase is here, and peptidyl transferase is initiating the reaction and making peptidyl bond. These peptide bonds are very, very necessary since they join our amino acids together. So here we can see there is a formation of peptide bond with the liberation of water molecule. That is how the formation of peptide bond occurs, and this bond is made by peptidyl transferase, which is present on the large subunit, that is 50S of our prokaryotic ribosome. And after that, the last process is translocation into it, in which this amino acid, this ribosomes, they make shift to the right side so that they can move on to the next mRNA. So in this, the ribosome makes move, and it has to move so that it can read new sequence once the reaction is done on the pre-existing sequence. So after translocation, we'll move on to the last process, that is termination. In termination, we had seen that during genetic codon, we had seen that there are three stop codons. So they are UAA, UAG, and UGA, and they are stop codons because they do not have any tRNA against them. So since they don't have any tRNA, so they stop the reaction. So in this, few more proteins are getting attached to it, that is a release factor, RF1, RF2, and RF3. So like we are seeing here, these are release factor proteins which are coming and attaching to the sites. And the reaction triggered by release factors like peptidyl transferase releases the polypeptide from the tRNA in the ribosomal P site. Then the tRNA is released from the ribosome and the two ribosome subunit and RF dissociate from mRNA. And the initiator amino acid is usually cleaved from the polypeptide. So we see the structure. This is a structure of termination. Here, this is our complex. Reaction has done, and it has added many more amino acids after serine. Here we can see UAG has come onto the A site. So it is a stop codon. So there is nothing, no tRNA against it. So now instead of any sort of tRNA, release factor would come and it will attach to this place, that is A site. And release factor binds to stop codon. Since it has come here, now it will stop. It will stop the binding of the all these structures, and it would bind to the stop codon. And since it has bounded to stop codon, in the next step, what it will do? It will release the polypeptide chain by the cleavage of peptide bond from here. So here it has broken down, and now the polypeptide is free. And after that, the components will disintegrate. Large subunit would go from small subunit, mRNA would go from the system, tRNA and these release factors would again leave the complex, and the entire assembly would disintegrate into their respective fragments. So with this, we are done with our translation part. And if you have any doubt or any query, you can contact us in our departmental things. We do have many digital platforms where you can put your questions or query. So we do have blog, we do have Facebook page, and we have YouTube channel also. So subscribe us, share us, and enjoy your studies. Thank you.